have Mary answer again.
I don't know the two calls.
Hello and welcome to the Eucharistic celebration of the Sacrament of Confirmation. Our celebrant for today's liturgy will be Bishop Ramón Bejarano. Out of reverence for the liturgy, please turn off or silence all cell phones. Finally, pictures may be taken after Mass at the altar, both of them one at a time. You're free to leave right after Mass if you'd like or to stay and take pictures. Thank you, the Mass will begin shortly.
Thank you.
celebrate the sacrament of confirmation for all these young men, young men and women. We give thanks to the Lord for their lives. So I want to welcome also the families, you know, the parents, grandparents, and any other members of the family. So I also want to welcome anyone who is joining us for the celebration also through the internet, through the live streaming. So I know that some people are following us also and joining us in prayer. So as it was said at the beginning, I'm Ramón Bejarano. I've been only a bishop for 10 months, so just a baby bishop. and making a lot of mistakes, you know, making a lot of mistakes. But one of the things that I can assure you is that the confirmations are going to be bad. So again, it's a blessing to be here with all of you, and as we prepare to celebrate all these wonderful blessings and gifts and mysteries, let us then ask the Lord to forgive us from our sins, and especially to accept and embrace the mercy that He gives to each one of us. I confess
to Almighty God and to you, my brothers and sisters, that I have greatly sinned in my thoughts and in my words, what I have done and what I have failed to do. Through my most grievous fault. Therefore, I ask the Blessed Mary, ever Virgin, all the angels and saints, and you, my brothers and sisters, to pray for me to the Lord our God.
May Almighty God mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life.
Amen.
Let us pray.
Your spirit and renew the face of the earth. reading from the Acts of the Apostles. When the time for Pentecost was fulfilled, they were all in one place together. And suddenly there came from the sky a noise like a strong driving wind, and it filled the entire house in which they were. Then there appeared to them tongues as of fire, which parted and came to rest on each one of them. And they were all filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in different tongues, as the Spirit enabled them to proclaim. Now there were devout Jews from every nation under heaven staying in Jerusalem. At this sound, they gathered in a large crowd, but they were confused because each one of them heard them speaking in his own language. Then Peter stood up to feel of them, raised his voice, and proclaimed, "You who are Jews, indeed all of you staying in Jerusalem, let this be known to you, and listen to my words. You who are Israelites, hear these words. Jesus the Nazarene was a man commended to you by God with mighty deeds, wonders, and signs, which God worked through him in your midst, as you yourselves know. This man, delivered up by the set plan and foreknowledge of God, you killed using lawless men and crucified him. God raised this Jesus, of this we are all witnesses. Exalted at the right hand of God, he received the promise of the Holy Spirit from the Father and poured it forth as you both see and hear." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Bishop Ramón, we will now begin the process of confirming the confirmandi.
All those who are going to be confirmed, will you please stand? For the candidates for confirmation? Yes, the candidates for confirmation, those who are going to be confirmed. Thank you so much. For the presentation of these candidates. I know that it has been a challenge, you know, the last year for all of you, you know, to be able to continue your catechetical instruction and be able to be here receiving this sacrament. You know, a lot of things kind of changed, you know, this last year. But I also want to thank Pat, you know, the whole team of catechism, who help also so that you could continue your growth in the faith and be able to be here today. So I want to invite all of you to please join me in giving thanks to God for these fine young men and women, you know, who today are going to be receiving that this sacrament. So if we can give them a round of applause. The very day of your baptism, you receive that Spirit. You receive the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit already dwells in you, is in you. As Jesus says in the Gospel, the Holy Spirit will be with you, will be in you. So it's already there. So if the Holy Spirit is already in you, why do we need to do the confirmation? Why do we need to ask, you know, the Holy Spirit to come upon you? Well, it's precisely because we are, through the sacrament of confirmation, renewing our commitment to live our faith, and at the same time renewing the openness of our lives to let the Holy Spirit work in us, be in us, and to renew then the strength of the Holy Spirit in our lives. Precisely the word confirmation comes from confirmare, which means to give strength. That's what we're celebrating. The Holy Spirit giving you strength. It happens in our life, right? I mean, now that you are young adults, you know, you are much wiser, you have more knowledge, I mean, you're stronger, you know, you are different. So precisely the same thing. What you have received in the sacrament of baptism now, he wants to receive more strength, more maturity in your life so that you can live your faith and live it to its fullness. So today, as you receive this gift, then you have to use it. Because if you don't use the gift of confirmation, you're never going to know what the Holy Spirit is able to do in your life. Like any other gift, you need to open it and you need to use it. So that at least, you know, you will be able to see what that gift is able to do in your life. If you just put it in the closet, you know, and just throw it away, then it's not going to do anything good. There was a time when there were two men, you know, talking to each other, and one was saying to the other friend, "I don't know what to do with my wife. She keeps asking me for money all the time. Just 2 weeks ago, she asked me for $600. Just last week, you know, she asked me for $800. Just yesterday, she asked me for $1,000. Gosh, my friend, what does your wife do with all that money? I don't know, I've never given it to her." So he never gave her the opportunity to show, you know, what she could do with that money, right? Maybe she was a very good administrator. Maybe she could have, you know, renewed the house. Maybe she could have got new furniture. I don't know. Maybe she could have arranged, you know, maybe a nice trip, you know, for a vacation for the whole family. But he never gave her the opportunity to show. The same thing with each one of us. We need to give the Holy Spirit that opportunity. What is the Holy Spirit able to do in my life? Now, there are many, many things that the Holy Spirit does in our lives. I'm going to mention only three things today, you know, that the Holy Spirit does in our lives. But there are many, many other things, you know, that the Holy Spirit does in each one of us. But first, the Holy Spirit helps us to see Jesus with different eyes. Think about the apostles. Today we heard, you know, the second reading about the time of Pentecost. Well, they were with Jesus for 3 years, They learned so much from Jesus' teaching. They saw Jesus' miracles. And they still, you know, couldn't understand who Jesus was. They were not sure. They had some expectations about Jesus, but still, they didn't understand a lot of the things that Jesus was telling them. And even after the death and resurrection of Jesus, some of them were not sure. Is this possible? I mean, is it possible that this guy who was just killed, you know, a few days ago, now is risen, and he has appeared to us, and he's not a ghost? So it wasn't until Pentecost, when the outpouring of the Holy Spirit came upon all the disciples, that they were able then to see, to understand everything that Jesus taught them, and to be able to see and recognize who Jesus is. As Lord, as Savior, precisely when you read, you know, the Acts of the Apostles, you're always going to be then seeing the preaching of the apostles. This is Jesus, this is the Lord, the name that has been given by heaven. You know, there is no salvation but in the name of Jesus. The Holy Spirit then helps us and reveals to us who Jesus is, changes our eyes so that we don't see Jesus as a historical figure, as someone, you know, who maybe was a very good prophet or someone who did a lot of good things, or, you know, so that we are able to see Jesus here, now. He is present. He is alive. He is in me. And he loves me. But the second thing that the Holy Spirit does in our lives helps us to understand how valuable we are. How valuable we are. There was a time when a father was telling his son, I'm going to inherit to you my 74 Chevy pickup. It's going to be yours. You know, my father inherited to me. Now I'm going to inherit it to you. But in order for you to have it, you need to find out how much is the value of the pickup. So go to the car dealership and ask them, you know, how much are they willing to give you for the pickup? So the son goes, you know, takes the pickup, you know, to the dealership, comes back and says, Dad, you know, they're saying that they're willing to offer me $10,000. Because, you know, it's going to need new paint, you know, it's going to need, you know, the body of the pickup is going to need some repairs, you know, the tires need to be changed, you know, the motor probably is going to have to be rebuilt, you know, all these kind of things. So that's what they are offering. Okay, well, now I want you to take the pickup to the classic car club in town, you know, and ask them, how much are they willing to give you for the pickup? He goes and comes back and says, Dad, it's amazing. They are willing to give me $100,000 just as it is. Just as the pickup is right now, $100,000. Precisely so. It is the same thing with each one of us. The same thing with you. Maybe there are going to be some people in this life who are never going to value, give you the right value that you have. But there are many others who will truly know how valuable you are, and be able then to celebrate that gift of your the love that you have for your family, from your friends, and from God. So the Holy Spirit helps us to see that even if some people don't care about us, there are many others who do, because you are very precious. You are the price of the blood of Jesus. You are more than gold. So you are so valuable because Jesus precisely gave his life for you. So imagine how valuable and precious and amazing is your life. The Holy Spirit will help you to be able to realize that. And thirdly, finally, the Holy Spirit is going to help you also to fulfill your purpose in life. Each one of us have a purpose in this life, a God-given purpose, and we need to find it. It's revealed to us, you know, through life, but we need to make the right decisions so that we can, again, do that purpose. Some of you in your life, most of you probably are going to end up, you know, getting married, you know, having a family. Some of you might decide, you know, to be single, you know, it's possible. Some of you, I've never heard it, it's possible that some of you say, the Lord is coming. calling me to be a priest, or the Lord is calling me, you know, to be a religious sister. It is possible. Again, it's your God-given purpose in life. But whatever you end up doing in life, if you become a doctor, if you become an attorney, if you become a business person, if you become, you know, an artist, you know, or a singer, whatever, something that is very important in this purpose in life is to know that everything that we do, if we do it only for ourselves, if we do it out of selfishness, we're never going to be happy. Because everything that we do in this life, whatever is going to be your career, should always be to make this world a better place and to be able to help others. When we are able to discover that I'm called to make this world a better place, and that I'm called then to help others, again, through whatever I end up doing, then we're going to be happy. We're going to truly find a real purpose in life. So don't hesitate to call the Holy Spirit every day. Say, "Come, Holy Spirit, tell me what to do. What decision do I need to make right now? Is this good? Is this bad? Come, Holy Spirit, because I'm right now, you know, in this predicament, in this trouble. I need your help." Why do you need to call the Holy Spirit to come to you if he's already here? Because it is already you, but precisely the Holy Spirit needs to be called. Like, you know, Father, you know, Thomas is here, right? You know, we know that he's here. All of us know that he's here. We can see him, but he's over there. If I say, "Father Thomas, please come over here, help me," then he's going to move from there, and he's going to be here to help me. The same thing with the Holy Spirit. It's already dwelling in you, but when you say, you know, "Come, Holy Spirit," the Holy Spirit is going to be there, right there, at that moment to help you, to guide you. Don't hesitate every day to say, to pray, "Come, Holy Spirit, help me and guide me in my life." When you were baptized, your parents made a commitment to teach you the faith, to show you the love of God. At that moment, they made a renunciation to evil, and they professed the faith that has been handed down to us generation after generation. Now that you are more mature, that you are young men and women, that you are able to speak for yourself, I want to ask you then to renew also your baptismal promises. Do you renounce Satan and all his works and empty promises? Do you? I didn't hear it. You know, I'm becoming old, you know, my ears, you know, my hearing is not that great. So, do you do? I do. Okay, great, thank you. Now I can hear you. So, do you believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth? Do you believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was born of the Virgin Mary, suffered death and was buried, rose again from the dead, and is seated at the right hand of the Father? Do you believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who today, through the sacrament of confirmation, is given to you in a special way, just as he was given to the apostles on the day of Pentecost? Do you believe in the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting? This is our faith, This is the faith of the Church. We are proud to profess in Christ Jesus, our Lord. Amen. So, my dear friends, all of you here present, let us pray to God, the Almighty Father, for these His adopted sons and daughters, already born again to eternal life in baptism, that He will graciously pour out the Holy Spirit upon them to confirm them with His abundant gifts, and to His anointing conform them more fully to Christ, the Son of God. So I want to invite all of you with all your heart, in your mind, in a silent prayer, ask the Holy Spirit to come powerfully upon all these young men and women.
Thank you. Thank you.
please stand.
Brothers and sisters, as we continue to receive the guidance and the strength of the Holy Spirit, let us now present with confidence our prayers and intentions to the Lord.
For these confirmandi, confirmed by the gift of the Spirit, that they give witness to Christ by lives built on faith and love, we pray to the Lord. For their parents and godparents who lead them to faith, that by word and example they may always encourage them to follow the way of Jesus Christ, we pray to the Lord. For the Holy Church of God, in union with Francis our Pope, Robert and John and Ramon our bishops, and all the bishops, that God, who gathers us together by the Holy Spirit, may help us grow in unity of faith and love until his Son returns in glory, we pray to the Lord. For all people of every race and nation, that they may acknowledge the one God as Father, and in the bond of common brotherhood seek his kingdom, who is peace and joy in the Holy Spirit, we pray to the Lord.
God our Father, you sent your Holy Spirit upon the apostles, and through them and their successors, you give the Spirit to your people. May his word begun at Pentecost continue to grow in the hearts of all who believe, through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Please be seated.
Thank you. pray, brethren, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God in body and blood.
May the Lord accept the sacrifice at your hands for the praise and glory of his name, for our good and the good of all his holy church.
Receive your mercy, O Lord, the prayers of your servants, and grant that being conformed more perfectly to your Son, they may grow steadily in bearing witness to him, as they share the memorial of his redemption, by which he gained for us our Holy Spirit, through Christ our Lord.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks. Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord, ascending above all the heavens and sitting at your right hand, he put out the promised Holy Spirit on your adopted children. Therefore now, and for ages and ages, with all the hosts of angels, we sing to you with all our hearts, crying out as we acclaim. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of hosts, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna. You are indeed holy, O Lord, the fount of all holiness. Make holy, therefore, these gifts, we pray, by sending down your Spirit upon them like a dewfall, so that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. At the time he was betrayed and entered willingly into his passion, he took bread and giving thanks, broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, take this, all of you, and eat of it. For this is my body, which will be given up for you. Similar way when supper was ended, he took the chalice and once more giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, take this, all of it, and drink from it. For this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be put out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me. The mystery of faith, we proclaim your death, O Lord, and profess your resurrection until you come again. Therefore, as we celebrate the memorial of his death and resurrection, we offer you, Lord, the bread of life and the chalice of salvation, giving thanks that you have held us worthy to be in your presence and minister to you. Humbly, we pray, the partaking of the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit. Remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world and bring her to the fullness of charity. Together with Francis, our Pope, Robert, our Bishop, John, his assistant, me, your unworthy servant, and all the clergy. Remember also our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection. And all who have done your mercy, welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray, that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with Blessed Joseph, her spouse, spouse, with the blessed apostles and all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, who may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life, and may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ.
Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. Amen. Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb.
Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be.
Instruct, O Lord, in the fullness of the law, those you have endowed with the gifts of your Spirit, and enriched by the body of your only begotten Son, that they may constantly show to the world the freedom of your adopted children, and by the holiness of their lives, exercise the prophetic mission of your people. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen. I don't know if there are any announcements, but I want to thank again all of you for the opportunity. Thank you, Father Tom, and Deacon Mark, and Deacon Kevin, and especially everyone who helped, you know, with the liturgy, with the music, with the live streaming, with the other preparations for the liturgy. But in a special way also, the team, you know, that helped, you know, with the confirmation. So who are all the members of the core team that helped, you know, with the confirmation? Yeah? Very good. So thank you. Thank you. Thank you, Pat, you know, for your leadership and for continuing to help us guide, you know, also our youth here toward a growth in their faith. So thanks. And of course, you know, we want to continue to give thanks to the Lord for all this confirmandi, you know, those who have received the gift of confirmation. So let's give them another round of applause.
Certificates for teens, so I'm clear they're already at work, the water for the pews, so I'll come back.